Welcome to the conversation, Writing, the Arts, and the Creative Spirit. This is Sharon Laborde. Thank you for joining me today. In my essays on writing, I've talked about memoirs and writing about everyday life. As an example of writing about a personal experience, or what you know, I'm reading an essay today from a series on Southern ghosts that I posted back in 2011. Here's an example of how a memory from the past can be used as a topic for writing. And now for the story of another Southern ghost. Have you ever heard a voice without being able to identify the speaker? Sure, we all have. Maybe the voice carries from another room, or perhaps we hear a spoken word or phrase from across a distance. But if you are alone and hear a disembodied voice, take my word for it, it can really rattle the nerves. The story I'm about to tell took place many years ago when I was in my final year at Alabama College, now known as the University of Montevallo in Montevallo, Alabama. I had married the fall of my senior year and moved into a house located directly across the street from campus in this small southern town. It was a wonderful old house, built in 1819, the year Alabama became a state, named the Calkins House for a former music professor who had lived there many years before. It was built along traditional southern lines. There was a wide entrance hall that ran the length of the house, with large equal-sized rooms on either side. Every room had a fireplace, and believe me, they were needed in that old house, since the ceilings were about 14 feet high. During the winter, you could stand on a chair in the living room and actually feel a little warm. At one time, there had been a porch across the back of the house, but that had been enclosed in order to make a kitchen and a bathroom, with a back door positioned between the two rooms. Of course, when the house was built, the kitchen was a separate structure in the backyard. No traces of the former kitchen remained. However, the old carriage house still stood. The house was designed for the intense summer heat of Alabama, when the only relief came from opening the doors and the tall windows that still contained the original wavy glass. It was a great old house, built to last out of heart pine, impervious to termites, and it still stands today, gracing the lovely small town of Montevallo. I love that house. Yes, it was shabby, and it had seen better days, but it had style. I could imagine what it would look like with some repairs and the proper furniture, but unfortunately, we were poor at the time, struggling college students during the tumultuous 1960s. Our lifestyle as a newly married couple was probably not that different from many other young people of the day. We were restless and ready to get on with our lives, although we didn't know what that would involve exactly. We protested against the Vietnam War and had people in and out of the house all day between classes, discussing the topics that were important to us. Most of my friends were majoring in the humanities, and my husband's friends were, for the most part, the scientific types in math or science. It began in the spring of that year, 1969 to be exact. With the return of warmer weather, I spent time in late afternoons after class soaking in the tub in the one bathroom at the back of the house. The bath had a door that opened into the back bedroom and one that opened into the long hallway that ran the length of the house. I would fill the tub as full as I could safely get in and luxuriate for at least 20 or 30 minutes before trying to figure out what to cook for dinner or start studying. On one particular afternoon around the 1st of April, I was soaking in the tub, daydreaming, no doubt, when I heard a distinct voice speak to me. "Hello, honey," it said. Surprised, I immediately thought it was one of our friends out in the hallway, and rather than have an unwanted visitor in the bathroom with me, I gave a shout and said, "I'm in the bath." Nothing. No response. Strange, I thought, and quickly got out of the tub, slipped into the bedroom, and got dressed. Next, I investigated to see if anyone was there. I was the only one in the house. Must have been my imagination, I thought, but I was puzzled. It was such a distinct voice. If it was my imagination, it sure did happen a lot. I can't remember how many times I heard that voice while I was in the tub. It was, I began to realize, a woman, and her voice had a special sweetness. Always, there was only a simple greeting like, "Hello, honey," or "Hello, sweetheart." I must say, except for the first time or two I heard it, I was never really disturbed by the voice, and it wasn't long before I began to realize it was not an actual spoken endearment I was hearing, but rather something I heard inside my head. I know, you probably think that's crazy, but that's the way it was, the way I thought of it. Needless to say, I didn't share any of this with my new husband. He was much too pragmatic. If there was not a scientific explanation, it was bull. That would have been his attitude, so I didn't bother to fill him in. Reluctant to share, and perhaps be laughed at. Maybe that says something about the marriage, even back then. It was one of those first tiny hairline cracks in the relationship. Who knows? Anyway, it wasn't long before he became a believer. I seem to remember everything coming to a head around the end of May. It was late afternoon, actually almost twilight, and I was washing dishes at the kitchen sink. The room was long and narrow, what you would expect from a converted back porch. The sink was on the back wall of the room, with a window above it looking out on the backyard and the carriage house. To my right, as I stood at the sink, was a window that faced the house next door, the home of two retired maiden professors from the college. Again, I was in a very relaxed state of mind. That's when I would be most likely to hear her. As I mentioned earlier, I had begun to think of the voice as female and had gotten over the initial response of being startled when I heard her. Still, there was always a sense of surprise, and it had been some time since she had spoken to me. I can remember gazing out the window as I washed the dishes, thinking about nothing in particular when I heard her speak. "Wash 'em up, baby. Wash 'em up." I immediately looked to my right toward the open window, caught off guard, briefly thinking, it must be one of the ladies from next door. I actually walked to the window and looked out. No one was around, of course. Good manners would have never allowed the professors from next door to speak to someone inside their house through a window. It would have been a breach of social etiquette, voyeurism beyond the pale. So it was only a passing thought on my part, and I soon realized it was my visitor. But it wasn't long before I also realized there was a difference this time. There seemed to be a consciousness about the voice. After all, there was the recognition that I was washing dishes. That has to be important, I can remember thinking. I also remember beginning to doubt myself, as I usually did after hearing her, always trying to find an explanation. At the same time, I was disconcerted that whatever was speaking to me was aware of my actions, like washing the dishes, and that maybe, I was being observed all the time. That was a creepy feeling. Several days went by. It was late afternoon, just at twilight, and I was again in the kitchen doing something around the sink, perhaps preparing a meal. I really don't remember. I had washed clothes earlier in the day. There was a washing machine in the house, but no dryer. In those days, almost everyone had a clothesline in the backyard and hung their clothes out to dry. Much earlier in the afternoon, I had hung the laundry out on the line, and as night began to fall, my husband walked down the back steps to bring in the dry items. He was out there for a while, but when he came in the back door, I knew instantly, without his saying a word, that he had heard her. Remember, I had never mentioned the voice, but when I looked at his face, I knew. You heard her, didn't you? She said, hang 'em up, honey, hang 'em up. Was it a woman, I asked? I had just reached up to take down the first sheet when I heard her voice, he said. I don't understand it. I was taking them down, but she was telling me to hang them up. I thought at first it might be Miss Pete or Miss Maroney, but I looked around and they weren't out in their yard. The voice was so close. It was in your head, I said. We didn't talk about it very often, and I hate to say that the house seemed rather empty afterwards. I suppose sharing her with someone else had broken the bond between us, and I never heard her again. But I was always listening for her, and of course she didn't respond. At the end of spring semester, we moved into a more comfortable, modern apartment, and our lives went on. Through the years, in those rare moments when we talked about the old house, we would relive that experience, forever part of our shared history. The skeptic was not convinced, but could never explain the voice he had heard. I began to understand that she was the spirit of a lost soul. My hope is that she has found her way home. I'm so pleased you could join me today on Welcome to the Conversation. I'll be back soon with a few more ideas about writing, interviews with fascinating people, and reports on the creative spirit that is alive and well here in the beautiful Ozark Mountains of Northwest Arkansas and Missouri, USA. Until next time, this is Sharon Laborde, cultural editor of Ozark Harvest Radio.
VIP Medical Services is a direct primary care medical practice located in Ozark, Missouri. Direct primary care, or DPC, offers primary care directly to the consumer without insurance administration. Here at VIP Medical Services, DPC means more time spent with each member, and each member has direct contact to our physician 24/7 via cell phone, email, and even video chat. Our mission is to provide high quality, cost effective, direct primary care.
If you're interested in direct primary care, please contact us at 417-485-4847 or visit us on the website at ozarksvipmedical.com.
This is Sharon Laborde, publisher at Cahaba Press, a small publishing house located in Northwest Arkansas. Are you an independent author? Are you ready to publish your manuscript? I'll be happy to answer your questions about editing, formatting, and cover design. Details of the publication services offered at Cahaba Press are available on the website cahabapress.com or email me at publisher@cahabapress.com. I'll be happy to help you with your creative project.